Okay, so I'm very glad to be here, and I thank the organizers and also all of you to to be still there. I'm going to talk, what I'm going to do is a report on a PhD thesis of great Holkar, who is a student of Ralph Meyer in Göttingen, and who defended his thesis just last week. And I think now he's in Brazil. So, and I was involved because he asked me some questions that put me back to very some old work. So what I should say that the techniques, the tools are fairly ancient. It goes back to Cohn's paper 78 on non-commutative integration, survey of foliation, Cohn-Scandalis longitudinal index, but it's really at the level zero. That means at the level of C-star algebras. It's not no pseudo-differential operators, no case theory, just constructing C-star algebras and from groupoids. So let me state what I consider the main results. So it's saying that the construction of the C-star algebra of a groupoid is a functor, is a covariant functor from some category of groupoids, so which I will define, to what I call the category of C-star algebras. Not everybody would agree what it is, where the objects are C-star algebras and the arrows are C-star correspondences. I will review the definitions. So that's what I'm going to talk about. So what I will do is I will first review the construction of the C-star algebra of a groupoid. You have seen it, and it has been mentioned in a number of talks, but nevertheless, let me construction of the C-star algebra. Okay, it generalizes some well-known construction. So F, when I say a space, it's a locally compact second countable. It's not always needed, but for safety, second countable, and Hausdorff. So X is a space, and we all know that the continuous function vanishing at infinity is a C-star algebra. And in fact, any commutative C-star algebra is so obtained. If G is a locally compact group, we know how to construct the convolution C-star algebra. In fact, there are many C-star algebras that you can contain. I will stick to the full C-star algebra. And you can combine both. So if G is a transformation group, then, you can combine. So this cover this, but there is a slight variation about that, and which is useful in particular when defining the cyst algebra of a foliation, so a little more general. So if G is a groupoid, okay, then we can construct, okay, and at this stage what I want to say, okay, I recall you start with the continuous function with compact support, so take two elements, the convolution product, just as the case in a group is given by, okay, this formula that you have all seen. So here we need to integrate with respect to gamma 1. So gamma 1, it's a groupoid, so the range of gamma 1 has to be equal to the range of gamma. So here we need lambda, called lambda x. So lambda x is a measure on the fiber gx. My notations, the range map is denoted by R, the source map is denoted by S. It's my notation. And you want continuity condition. So for F in CC of G, X gives the integral is continuous and equivariance. Gamma lambda S of gamma. Okay, you're probably those who have seen groupoids and groupoid cyst algebras are the first thing to do. And so it's really part of the construction. So we need, in the case of a group, that's the Haar measure. It's unique up to scalar. In the general case, it's an extra data that we put. So I should put a lambda here, and we'll see how to deal with that. And then you complete, in fact, you have the notion of representation to bounded operator on some Hilbert space, so it's a representation, and you can show that these representations are bounded by the L. If they are continuous in some weak sense, they will be bounded by some L1 norm, and you define full norm, and that gives you the cyst algebra. Okay, and I didn't say the formula for the involution. And okay, but the case. No, there is an idea. I would have liked to give a complete answer for of this theorem in the case of Lie groupoids. Then you defined CC of G. They are no longer complex valued functions, but they are sections of some bundle. So I should say CC infinity of G. So here you take the half densities on the fibers of the source map. And again, take two elements here, and you want to make sense of this formula. So here I put some product. And again, you integrate over the fiber G of R of gamma. And the formula for involution and an exercise makes sense. Of these formulas. It's not completely obvious. It requires some identifications. And another point, okay, again, there is the notion of representation, which is completely intrinsic. If you want to show that the representations are bounded, then you have to introduce L1 norms. But L1 norms are not intrinsic. So you can always, okay, this is a line bundle. You can always trivialize by choosing lambda's equivalent section of the bundle over. Okay, so if you trivialize, then you can you get a basis, so you can write any f as f lambda. So here tilde is the inverse map, so you get something like that. Lambda. And you will see that here you can speak of the L1 norm of f lambda. And in fact, you get a better estimate. For you will see that you can take so the estimate is the following: f1, where f1 is the max of, you integrate f of gamma with respect to lambda x. And take the supremum of x, and same thing with the star. And it depends on lambda. So, in fact, there is a norm which is the infimum over all the sections lambda. That gives a little bit, slightly better estimate. Okay, so that's the usual presentation, the construction of system algebra. But for my purpose, I want to give another presentation. Which is based on the notion of C-star category. So it's something, which was developed by Guess, Lima, and John Roberts in the 80s. So the idea is simple. Instead of considering one Hilbert space, so the bounded operators from that space into itself, just a low collection of Hilbert spaces. And instead of dealing with one C-star algebra, you have a collection of A, B, which are C-star algebras. In fact, you define A, B, which is the objects. So we don't even need to put. So these are the objects in collection. AV are binary spaces, and you get map bilinear maps so x y gives x, y, and a star, a, b, to BA, X gives X star. And you want the usual norm equalities. So the norm of a product is measurized by products of the norm. The involution is isometric, and of course you want X star X to be norm X square. So it's a convenient, and the nice thing about it is that you see immediately that AB will be, for instance, a B C star module. So and same thing on the left. Because you have an obvious product, you take X, so here it will be X star X, the product. And of course, it's a BB right module. So it's a convenient way. So let's construct the C star category of a groupoid as follows. So G is a groupoid. So X, I want X alpha. So X is a proper G space. Here, let's choose a left G space. So we have seen that we need a moment map from X to G0. So we put alpha, which is alpha U. Alpha U is a measure on XU, which is RX minus 1 U, and which satisfies exactly the same condition as where did I write the conditions? Just above. So a continuous. So consider these objects and then form the following category. So the objects will be these things, and then consider alpha beta that will be the alpha f beta. So here I will have y beta and z gamma and so on. So consider these things where now f is a function on x star y. So when I write x star y, it's just the fiber product here is over g null. Have the diagonal action of G here and I quotient. And I want to define here the product from alpha beta plus beta gamma to alpha gamma. So and alpha, I do alpha f beta beta g gamma, that will be alpha, here the convolution over beta of g, and where the convolution is given by, okay, it's our usual formula. I view these functions are g invariant functions on x star y. So I don't bother to put classes. So xz, which is given by f of xy, g of yz, d beta of y. Here I should say range x of x, for instance, or something like that. So a very natural, just convolution of kernels. and a similar formula for alpha beta to beta alpha, given alpha f beta star is beta f star alpha, and f star of yx is f of xy. Okay, so now this is not a C-star category, but it plays. So it's I still call it a CC of G. So a star category. And probably the main, the only result, and in fact, which, in that any representation of the star algebra CC of G continues for the inductive limit topology extends to. So the main theorem, so it's an old result of mine, T7, is that the representations of the star algebra CC of G are the same as the representation of the star category. Of course, a representation of the star category gives you a representation of the star algebra, but you don't lose anything, you can extend. And which is still denoted here, and the proof relies on disintegration of representation. That's the main tool. But once you've got that, then you can complete, so corollary, you can complete CC of G. CC of G can be completed into a C star category, which I will denote again by C star of G. So it's a cheap way to construct C star modules. Whenever you have a proper G space and a system of measures like this, you get a C star module. If you go back to your favorite construction, in fact, Riffel's projections can be constructed this way. In fact, there are very natural proper, in fact, in that case. I was, in this paper, I was only considering a free and proper or principal G-spaces. And in these discussions with Reut Holkar, we just realized that it worked, the same formulas worked exactly the same for proper G-spaces. What should I say? Okay, but also look, I said in that situation, you see, we have a right C-star module, a left C-star module. So if you apply this here, suppose that you have x star x over g, y star y over g, and here you put above x star y over g. C star okay, these are groupoids, and here you get what's called an equivalence of groupoids. So corollary, an equivalence of groupoids implements an equivalence, a Morita equivalence of sister algebra. Okay, in Morita equivalence, you require the sister module to be full. So you want the inner product to generate the whole algebra. It's an ideal, you generate the whole algebra. And the fullness condition is realized when X and Y are proper G spaces. Free and proper. Yes, thank you. Okay, and another byproduct of this presentation is the following. So it's an observation. So we have defined by this trick. Now, if X is free, then, as I said implicitly, this is a groupoid. The multiplication law is just the usual one, XY. Here, these are the classes. Here, XY, YZ. Equal xz. This does, if not, this is not well defined. Because if you change, if you multiply by the isotropy of y, okay, here y doesn't change, but x changes. So what you get is xi x, where xi is in the isotropy of y. So we've got a product, but the product of two elements is no longer a third element, it's a set. In fact, it is better not to think of it as a set, but as a probability measure. The probability measure is the Haar measure of the compact group GY. The action is proper. So the gadget that you obtain is that it deserves the name of upper groupoid, and it's a very natural object. Hypergroups, example. So if K is a compact subgroup of a group G, then, and if you take X equal G mod K, then you'll see that X star X mod G is nothing but the double coset space, and you recover the usual convolution and the usual convolution algebra. There is a problem about completion, because you see, in this construction, I only consider representations coming from representation of G. So I will put a norm on that, which is not necessarily an intrinsic norm. And there are examples where the two norms don't coincide. The regular representation, there is no doubt about it. So that will be, if I take the regular representation of G, I will get the regular representation of the algebra. Okay, but I'll, that's all, it's a very interesting object which occurs in many contexts, and, but I'll, that's all I want to say about it today. Okay, now, this presentation of by sister category fits very well Lie groupoids. So now G is a Lie groupoid. So X is a proper and smooth G space. Here, I don't know, I no longer need this gadget alpha, this system of measures, because just defined xy to be the sections of this x star y mod g, and here you will take the densities, the half densities on the moment map of Rx, here of Ry, and quotiented by G. In fact, it's better, again, to view them as equivalent sections of that bundle. So an element here, f of xy, is just a density over x of Rx and half densities over y. And then you will see that the convolution, if you write the convolution product, this makes perfect sense. Because you get here half density in y, and you integrate over, again, over y, rx. So that gives a very easy presentation. But of course, there is this mysterious operation, which is taking the quotient over G. It corresponds to, at the level of sister algebras, it corresponds to taking the tensor product over a sister algebra. That's a Riffle's tensor product. Okay, so at this point, I've defined the construction of the sister algebra. Now, what is the category of sister algebras? And so, I should say, a sister correspondence. Okay, that's the new, so you've got two sister algebras. E is a sister, a right sister module over B, and you want a representation pi of A into the bounded operators of G. Okay, and you get composition. So if you have A, B, C, epsilon 1, epsilon 2, then you can form tensor product over B. Okay, with what we have seen, it's rather natural to define a groupoid correspondence in a similar way. So we've got a G, H, which are groupoids, and so I want now X is right proper H space, and I also want alpha as above. As above, not quite, because here I had left spaces, here I have right space. So I will write it as an alpha U downstairs, U in H0 as above. But let's forget for a time. Let's forget about this, and I want also X to be a left H space, a G space. Here, no condition. So that's what I would call a correspondence. So definition. Yes, and the action. When I say right and left, it means that the actions commute. And, commuting actions. Okay, so that's the definition. But if I want to pass to C star algebras, okay, I already mentioned that. We have H, which has some R system beta. G, if I want in the locally compact setting, I wanted to have our system lambda, and I've got my X alpha. We have already seen that C star we have defined C star of X alpha as C star H beta module. Now, we need to define an action here. So we want to define the action. So F will be in CC of H, Xi will be in CC of X, and you want to define F Xi X by our usual formula, F of gamma Xi gamma minus 1 X D lambda, you integrate with respect to gamma, and here you want A of X, you want this. Okay, it's not always, you get homomorphism, but to want, so you get something from CC of H into L. It is bounded, but to get a star representation, okay, so to get a star representation, need a condition which is need alpha u to be a quasi-invariant with respect to G lambda. Okay, it's a technical condition. So there exists delta, its continuous function from the cross product, or I call it the semi-direct product G acting on X in value, with positive values, and such that the integral of f, so you integrate a function here, so continuous with respect with compact support in x, f of x gamma, so you integrate it with respect to lambda, and then you respect to alpha u of x. So here you want the range of gamma to be equal to the source to of x. If I'm confused. It's gamma x. So here you want the source of gamma to be equal to the range of x, and okay, quasi-invariance means invariant, quasi-invariant under the inverse map. So f gamma, the inverse map gives you this, and you get a delta gamma minus 1 gamma x, and same thing, d lambda gamma d alpha u of x, rx. Okay, now comes the difficult time to clean the board. Okay, so that's the condition, and once you get this condition, you check easily that you get a star representation. Okay, that's true. You have to change, modify the formula and put a delta 1/2. That's true. Now, what I'm still not able to do. Is consider the case of Lie groupoids. So you say just write. In fact, the problem now is suppose that G. So you have G. G H. X. So GH are Lie groupoids and X smooth GH space. And proper, so the in that setting, so X is fibered over H null and over G null. So here SX are X. Proper action of H is proper. And SX is a summation. Okay? And so we can build the system module just as we did. And we want to make a sense to the formula. So F should belong to CC infinity of G. So remember, it's, you take omega 1 half S. Or I should put a G, but I don't do it here. Or put it. Okay. And Xi. X. Okay, so here I forget about the action of G. So in fact, you will here you have to look at the quotient map. So that will be half densities here on the 5/π, if you can make sense of it. But you can. But it's better to look at this presentation. Psi G, psi H over H, omega 1 half. Okay, here in my presentations, it will be, so I view X as an H space, so it will be S, X tensor omega 1 half. And here, I view H again, so SH. So, you want to define a formula like this, F Xi, X here, H, is equal to integral of F here, gamma, something here Xi gamma minus 1 X H. So you want to make sense of this, and you see that you need to flip lift the inverse map. So here, X, you consider H acting, you consider G acting on X. So so it's the map which gamma X that you have encountered upstairs, gamma X, to the bundle omega. So here you put above it S of X and here S of H.
Don't you want to have G somewhere?
No. And I view it. No, that's what I want. I view this as a bundle of I have to check my format. No, I you're right, SG. And here, okay, no. Yeah, because you see, this thing belongs to omega f of gamma. Okay, I don't think I should do that in public. Okay, in any case, that's if I do this, I can make sense of this formula. But still, it remains to check that I get a star representation. But I want to go to now to the important point. which is composition. So we have seen in the C-star algebra setting, a composition is given by this tensor product. So now suppose that you have G1, okay, lambda 1, G2, lambda 2, G3, lambda 3, and you have correspondences X. How do you construct a correspondence here from, so you want Z tau. Okay, you have no choice about Z. It just be you take the fiber product X star Y, so fibered over the units of G2, and you quotient by the action of G2. The action G2 acts properly on X, therefore it acts properly on that. So let's write it as a definition like this. We need to construct this system of measures for we still have a map, an action of G3 on Z. So construct U. U is a unit of G3. You do it in two steps. The first step is, you see, you lift. So we this is a fiber product of a Y, and we get G1, 0, G2, 0, G3, 0. And now, we've got this measure beta u here, and we've got an alpha here, the fibers here are the same. So you get a measure here. So here you get something that I denote by alpha or beta u. So that gives you beta u alpha. So you get fibered measures here. And now, so you go up. Now you want to go downstairs. So in order to go downstairs, so you want to go from X star U to X star U mod G2. And where the fibers, we know that the fibers will be given by the Haar measure lambda, Haar system lambda 2. So, when does a measure on X star U factors through lambda 2? Now, there is an easy answer. What you do is that you lift it up to, I wrote X star Y, okay, acting on G2. So here we have measure we have the range map R, and we have okay, you and of course you have here the measures. This is a semi-direct product, so you've got R measures, R systems on that. So you get the source map here. Again, is valid. And you get a diagram like this. So you lift beta u alpha to here and check if it is invariant under the inverse map. You will see that it's not quite invariant under the inverse map, but it will Don't forget that we have a delta x here, and you have delta y. There will be a delta y which occurs, but you view delta y is a cocycle on a proper groupoid. So you can realize it as a co-boundary, and you can modify this. So there will be some function on x star y, such that this will be of the form tau u lambda 2. It's a little complicated, but the idea is rather simple. So that's the way you construct tau, and you check that tau is delta invariant, and you've got, so delta will be a cocycle here. You've got a correspondence from G1 to G2, so it will be a cocycle from G1, and delta will be from G1 acting on Z. And it can be computed in terms of delta x and b. I don't give the explicit expression. And the theorem. Is that, so I wrote tau this way, I just write it as beta star alpha by G2. So that's the composition. And the C star algebra of okay, this correspondence, the C star correspondence, G2, with respect to alpha, I wrote beta, alpha, okay, is isomorphic to the tensor product of the correspondence. Over C star of H. Of what's in between, it's a G2. So that's, that concludes the statement that I gave, that the construction of the C star algebra is a functor from this category of groupoid correspondences to the category of C star correspondences. So that's. Yes, so delta y, if you remember, was a cocycle on the semi-direct product G2 acting on y. Okay, G2 acting on y, in the definition, there is no assumption at all. But you can view it as a cocycle on G2 acting on x star y. Then G2 acting on x star y is a proper groupoid, because the action of, here I should be confused, because the action of G2 on x is proper. Therefore, the action of G2 on x star y is proper.
Yes.
Okay, I'm using the term, yes, again. Okay, it may not be a good term, but for me, a cocycle is a groupoid homomorphism. So, delta here is from G2 star, delta y from G2 starting acting on y into. It just satisfies usually, you see, delta gamma 1, gamma 2 is delta gamma 1, gamma 2. It's all what I say. That's a cocycle. And a coboundary is a cocycle which is here the quotient of two, which is of the form B composed with a range over B composed with a source, where B is a function on the unit space. That's, and it's a trick that cocycles with value on a proper groupoid with value in R, R plus are coboundaries. And in the smooth context, that can be also done smoothly.